Art and technology, you would not think, is a marriage made in heaven. But it has created a tool for artists that may be the very best tool in the paint box, better than the paintbrush, at least as equal to the pencil, that the 20th century has to offer really the 21st century to go into the newest of modern age. Computer art today is going to be our subject. I'm Rona Rutchik. I'm glad you could be with us. Audiences have been really, by now, comfortable with many kinds and styles of art. Picasso has even taught us that in realism, when figurative art is used, exaggeration and replacement of parts is something that doesn't scare audiences anymore. Non-objective art, which has been in art galleries and museums and in artist studios ever since the second decade of our generation, is now familiar to audiences and doesn't scare them quite so much. And how do you feel about metal sculpture now that you're used to seeing sculpture that's been made out of scrap metal, not only Carrara marble, which was once thought to be the beautiful kind of stuff that you could only make beautiful art from? We feel, although we may not understand non-objective and sculpture made out of metal as much as you would like, we're not so scared of it anymore. Audiences are really getting used to modern art. However, whenever there's something new on the block, whenever a new style, a new kind, a new source comes into the art world and into the gallery, audiences again recreate new definitions, worry about criticism, and wonder, is it art after all, and is it valid as art? Today, as we look at computer art, we're going to see quite what's going on and speak to an artist who's doing computer art and a philosopher who can help us think about whether or not it is valid. I'd like you to meet my guests. First, Professor David Smalley from the Studio Art Department at Connecticut College is a sculptor, a well-renowned sculptor whose pieces are in public and private collections in various states, and perhaps, David, other than in the United States?
There are a few pieces in England as well.
Isn't that wonderful? Well, welcome, and thank you for coming to Art Talk.
Thank you.
David, you have been a co-director at the Connecticut College Center for Art and Technology with Noel Zoller.
That's right.
And recently, I was delighted to attend a symposium that you did. Who was there at that symposium?
Well, it was the fourth biennial symposium for arts and technology that we put on at the college. And this time we had 72 presenters from all around the world, including Asia, in the fields of computer music, art, virtual reality, and other aspects of art and technology.
Mm. Well, Noel Zoller, Professor Zoller, is in the music department at Connecticut College, and he has been with you, director, for this center. At another time, Arts Talk would like to invite Noel to come and talk about the music, but for the time being, let's stick with the visual arts. I know Dr. Vogel, who is a professor in the philosophy department at Connecticut College. You too were invited to be a part of this symposium. What's a philosopher doing in the midst of an art and technology symposium?
Well, at that symposium, I was invited to chair a panel about the ethical implications of virtual reality. Virtual reality is a new and special sort of medium where the one is involved in a simulated reality, and it raises problems about what's real and what is imaginary, about what the implications are of being involved in imaginary spaces, about who controls technologies like that, and about whether such technologies will replace the media with which we've become more familiar.
Mm-hmm.
So computers taken to that extreme raise special kinds of questions about social implications and what have you. The computer art that we'll be looking at today, I don't think raise ethical questions exactly of those sorts, but they raise questions that are interesting to philosophers, having to do with what the nature of art is, about what the relationship is between what the classical thinkers called techne, a craft, and poesis, the making of beautiful things, and computer art brings together techné and poesis in new ways.
Mm-hmm. Some of those people on your panel had very interesting backgrounds. I noticed many of them were engineers as well as architects. Mm. And they seem to have this both left side of the brain and right side of the brain working at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
How did they, when they talked on your panel, did they come up with any kinds of ways that they feel that these questions could be answered with an audience? Or ways in which the audience could be more comfortable with this virtual reality kind of art?
Well, what seems to be the case is that what drives this art are developments in the military and entertainment fields. So there's an interesting connection between uses outside the realm of the fine arts and the fine arts.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is what the relationship is going to be between between those two areas.
Mm-hmm. There's an interesting sidebar on that. You're right that a lot of the people who are in the forefront of using this technology are the technologists, the engineers, and so forth. It's interesting to hear them tell that as they get more and more involved, they learn so much from the artists, and as the artists get more and more involved, they learn so much from the scientists,
mm-hmm.
from the technology people.
Yeah.
And there has always been a trend to take technologies developed in other areas and then apply them to art as they become available. And this certainly has happened with welded sculpture back in the early part of this century. So this kind of trickle-down of the technology to levels where lots and lots of artists can decentralize it and use it is an interesting fact
mm-hmm.
in that regard.
Now, you have a wonderful tape that is the only tape, I understand, of its kind, and you co-produced it with Rob Fisher. Tell me about this tape.
Well, the tape that we're going to show some pieces of on the program today is the first collection of the work of serious sculptors in using the computer as a tool. And you'll see a bunch of different ways that the computer is used. It's used as a design tool, a visualization tool, and it's actually used in some cases in which the computer becomes the sculpture itself.
Mm-hmm.
We began to do this project in relation to a conference that was held by the International Sculpture Center in Philadelphia in June of 92. And those of us who were invited to talk about what we were doing with computers submitted statements and videotapes and slides of the work. And it was presented there as a multimedia presentation. As soon as it was done, people in the audience said, when is the tape going to be available? And so we took that as a sign of enthusiasm, and Rob and I, with the cooperation of sonalists here in town,
mm-hmm.
Created a partnership between the International Sculpture Center and the Center for Arts and Technology and produced the video based on all the materials that had been put together at the Philadelphia conference.
Mm-hmm.
I understand several hundred copies of the tape have been sold worldwide, and it's becoming used in schools and libraries as a reference on work by sculptors in the computer.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a wonderful tape, a very interesting one. Let's take a look now so that our audience knows really what we're talking about when we talk about computer art.
I have found that the computer is now capable of rendering what might be called the natural language of mathematics directly into physical three-dimensional form. The computer-aided prototyping device, stereolithography, is a three-dimensional printer which usually renders the object in a thermosetting plastic. I consider the stereolithograph as a clay or wax first-generation impression which would then be reproduced in cast metal like titanium, with multicolored, anodized finishes. The forms I am studying are fluid abstracts of unusual symmetry. I have been designing linear forms on the Mac computer with a freehand drawing program. These are used in wire model making. I turn the lines into three-dimensional forms, either figures or simple shapes. I heat shrink plastic over the wire shapes and then make a plaster mold from this. Then I either cast or press porcelain into the mold to produce the final objects. I am both a sculptor and a landscape architect. Whenever possible, I try to unite my two professions by treating landforms and landscape furniture, such as benches and fountains, as sculpture. The computer is a wonderful design and visualization tool, particularly suited to designing things that others may make, such as a granite bench, because the design methodology is based largely on the conventions of drafting and construction documentation. The computer unlocked new avenues of realization. As a sculptor, there are ways that I view the world and interpret my life that are essentially sculptural, but could never be expressed as actual sculpture. I've always used drawing as a means to explore sculptural ideas that could never be realized because of time and financial constraints. The computer offers the ability to take these drawings several steps further, to give the fantasy the aura of tangibility. My concrete artworks are the result of an attempt to create lifelike three-dimensional kinetic landscapes that are controllable and sufficiently flexible that one can compose for them as one composes for an instrument, or choreograph them as one would a dance troupe. The interactive living sculpture and related corporate logo are composed of iron powder in a computer-controlled magnetic field. At a broad level, I'm committed to explicitly introducing the emotional, the personal, the intimate, and the sensual to the otherwise rather cerebral and disembodied atmosphere surrounding and directing most high-tech projects.
I'll watch your song. David Dorlach's a wonderful example of an artist, of an artist and technologist in this field. He's a young fellow who is at MIT in Boston, both a scientist and an artist by training, and he's really setting out to kind of humanize this computer art business. That sculpture, I don't think it was in the narration, is proximity sensitive. In other words, it lies there quite quietly until you come up to it. The computer senses that you're there, and the piece starts to do its little dance. And there's this wonderful interaction. I've watched audiences with this sculpture, and they at first don't know quite what to make of it, and then just as children automatically do, even grown-ups become delighted with the piece, and they get closer, and they realize that as they get closer, the sculpture becomes more active, and so there's a whole range of interactivity that that goes along with that piece, and it's very exciting to see. It raises interesting questions about longevity. Is this a monument that will be around in another 150 years? David doesn't seem to care. Mm-hmm. The artist doesn't seem to care. But it raises wonderful questions about the nature of art. When you can have an art object become as interactive as another person, right, instead of just sitting there, mm-hmm, this is really quite a wonderful.
It becomes a pairing.
Yep.
Let's take a look at some others, and then we will talk about some of those questions you bring up, David.
Dance of the Cybernauts, an environmental sculpture proposal commissioned by the Carnegie Science Center in Pittsburgh, represented a unique opportunity to wed scientific, architectural, and engineering computer software in the search for new art forms. From the field of crystallography emerged a methodology that uses computer programs to stimulate the growth of crystals. From the world of technology came space frame structures based on natural engineering principles. And from the fields of art and architecture came my desire to create a humane and accessible image that worked aesthetically with the site. Voronoi tessellation scientific software begins with a simulated cube of space in which are randomly distributed seeds that represent the centers of growth of crystals. Into this seedbed, I float an architectural simulation of the roof of the building, produced from scale drawings, specified by the architect. Software written specifically for this project allowed me to grow natural polycrystalline forms in the context of the architecture by moving a small cube around in the seedbed. As the cube encircles a seed, a crystal emerges. After months of exploration, I arrived at a solution based both on the precedent of the human figure in architectural settings and on contemporary figurative sculpture, such as the work of Dubuffet. A series of playful, semi-abstract figures encircles the roof, residing in the spaces between the trusses. I call the figures cybernauts. I then sent our data to MiroStructure, fabricator of space frames, who read the sculpture data and assign the proper engineering values of dimension, node size, and angle. A full-scale mock-up of one crystal was constructed. The edges and nodes of the sculpture are to be outlined in fiber optics, illuminated by a central interactive computer programmable full-color laser. This allows the sculpture to be fully animated in real time. Viewable for miles, the sculpture was conceived as public art and entertainment and presents a positive message about science and technology. I began my investigation into computers with a computer-aided design of a forged stainless steel sculpture for Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland in 1983. The subject of the sculpture was the computer. I decided to set aside all of my previous non-computer-related works and explore the symbolic sculptural expression made possible by the computer. I continue to work toward the completion of a sculpture entitled Kundalini, as well as computer animations and the development of computer-generated prints that provide enhanced three-dimensional illusions. My computer-designed work, as with my earlier non-computer-generated work, primarily explores my evolving views on human spirituality and sexuality. All shapes in nature are built in accordance with specific rules. My shapes, however, all proceed from purely mathematical rules, and it is from these rules that impossible, unheard-of shapes are born. I use a constructive solid geometry-based modeling. It has all kinds of geometric primitives, like a sphere and cylinder, and can also manipulate objects with free-form surfaces. I can unite, differ, intersect, and subtract between two individual objects. A unique feature of this system is that it maintains a history of commands for undoing and jumping back to an earlier step. The system can show us a command tree of these decisions. I'm excited by the notion that forms can be generated by manipulating the rules for form making. Applying a series of commands to one form enables me to generate a host of other forms. I create new forms by lifting and twisting planes, drawing lines, rounding off corners, or scooping out areas by plunging negative shapes into the forms on my screen. From all the shapes that were achieved during the growth of this tree, 7 were selected to be made into finished works. These are the forbidden fruits of the command tree. The command tree describes an exploration of both the realm of form and the insides of the computer as tool. Applied engineering has married ultraviolet sensitive resin with laser scanning technology to yield a new tool for plastic creation. The main feature of this system is that it treats three-dimensional form as an accumulation of two-dimensional cross-sections. After tracing and hardening one cross-section, the machine automatically moves up to do the same for the next section. When you witness the finished form rising slowly up out of the resin bath, you feel as if you are present at the birth of the world.
David, you can see his exuberance when that piece gets finished. Mm-hmm. But you must try to explain to me, if you can, how does that happen with the resins and the computer?
First of all, when he designs the piece in the computer, the not just the picture of the design, but the data about that design is stored in software. And it's stored as a series of two-dimensional rings, each ring representing one cross-section of the sculpture. That data is then fed to a laser. literally drives a motor which aims the laser, and the laser traces out on the surface of this bath of golden resin, this plastic resin, one of those rings. Now, the resin is designed to only set up under the light of a laser. It doesn't set up in air or by temperature. It sets up by laser light. Then the little elevator in that vat of resin drops a notch, exposing another layer of surface, and the computer draws, guides the laser to draw another ring. And this process goes on over and over again. The elevator inside the tub of resin drops a millimeter each time. And just as if you were building up a pot with clay coils, the computer is actually building up a sculpture of rings of resin. Then finally, at the end, it's a little deceiving because, of course, you see that as if that were the beginning of the process. Mm-hmm. The elevator raises up out of the soup, and the hardened resin sculpture is removed from the bath, as it mm-hmm. were. But it really is a moment of creation, as you can see his enthusiasm on the screen, because he's really never seen the piece in actual three-dimensional form.
Mm-hmm. Nor has he touched it.
Nor has he touched it, right.
Now, tell me about that. That's an idea that we as audience have a couple of questions about. An art piece is supposed to be something that humanly is created mm-hmm. and touched and felt and mushed around a little, if you would. This is a new world. Help us, the audience, help me, the audience, to be more comfortable with this.
Well, the idea of art as something being made by human hands is something that we cherish. The first art objects we have are really evidence of earlier peoples having been there, and we have evidence of their touch. And so it's something that we think is very special. This is art that's touched by a human mind, but not necessarily by human hands. It raises interesting questions. Can the artist make fine-tuning and adjustments the way he would if he were carving that resin? The answer, I think, is yes, but. Yes, he can make those fine-tuning adjustments in the computer. And so the artist has to believe very much in the reality of what he sees on the computer screen before it's committed to the resin. But this is not entirely without precedent. Large sculptures, such as the Calder piece in Hartford or other pieces that people might see, are by and large made by fabricators and not made by the artist himself. After all, that's too vast a project for an artist to work with. Architects, who are considered artists, don't really build the buildings themselves. They're built by other agents. Mm-hmm. To do this, but it can be a troubling issue if it isn't touched by a person. Is it art?
I wonder whether there are new skills that are involved in being able to imagine pieces like those. That is, would someone who could have done a more traditional sculpture sort of naturally move into this technology and use it to build sculptures like what we saw, or are there special abilities now that have to be in place for somebody to become a sculptor?
Well, I think it's evolving to a point where any traditionally trained sculptor will be able to use this technology. The software that Fujihata uses is very exotic, but in 5 years it won't be. Mm. The resin bath is not a widely used technology, except it's used in industry all the time. Mm. So it's presumably you'll be able to go to your neighborhood resin bath and make a piece of sculpture that way. The most important thing I've noticed, and it's an interesting question, is that computer uses for sculpture have been more easily adopted by sculptors than, let's say, the computer as a tool for painters or the computer as a tool for printmakers. Mm-hmm. It's as though sculptors are tool-oriented people anyway, mm-hmm. whether they work in clay or marble or whatever, and they seem less put off by this new technology mm-hmm. than many of the other traditional artists, such as painters and printmakers. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Yeah. We have another segment of the tape to look at, and let's do that. But a couple of the questions that I want you to think about as we look at these is that we've been seeing some art, and we'll continue to see some art that isn't real. And do we know the difference when we look at it as to what's been done, what is art, or whether it's on the machine? And can art be something that is, in fact, only on the machine? Let's take another look at the video now.
I built kinetic, programmable, free-falling water droplet fountains, the largest of which is the 6,912 nozzle, 12-foot linear fountain capable of generating 55,000 water droplets per second. It was recently shown at the National Home Builder Show in Las Vegas in January and the National Kitchen and Bath Show in Atlanta in March. The new valve weighs 2,600 pounds, and is run by a single computer, which programs the valve to produce shapes defined by free-falling water droplets. The shapes are multiple dancing ribbons, flipping squares, falling chevrons and stars, a metamorphosing diamond, and letters forming words in most Western European languages, Hebrew, Arabic, and Japanese. My sculpture is based on a formal vocabulary of geometric shapes and the arrangement of these elements into structures that contain a sense of balance and weight. My sculptures are not concerned with external subject matter, but rather with the harmony created by these relationships. In 1989, I executed a series of steel sculptures based on column forms, created entirely on the computer. I used the computer to create three-dimensional models, which I now render in photorealistic scenes. I have found this method of developing my creative ideas to be very productive because it allows me to identify and manipulate variations and possibilities with much greater speed than with traditional methods. Vegreville, a small agricultural community in Alberta, Canada, with a largely Ukrainian population, wanted to commission a monumental Ukrainian Easter egg to be built as a cultural symbol. I was approached because of my background in computer modeling and in the design of diverse and unusual structural forms. After creating a mathematical model of an idealized chicken egg, I tried to use the computer to conform a folded plate structure to the continuously changing curvature of the egg. However, after 6 months, all attempts at solving the problem in this manner failed. Egg painters make continual intuitive adjustments to fit a complex two-dimensional pattern onto a three-dimensional egg surface. In order to manufacture the egg, we had to compute the exact geometry of these adjustments to the pattern. A breakthrough came when I abandoned the folded structures and started anew with a really simple shape, an equilateral triangle. With this as a constant module, variations became predictable. The geometry fell into place, but only after entirely new mathematical modeling programs were developed. The next problem was the coloring pattern, which I wanted to make as authentically Ukrainian as possible. We had 3,512 triangular facets to turn into a pattern, and I wanted to limit the coloring to three colors with only one color per facet. This meant there were 3 to the 3,512th power number of unique patterns. Needless to say, we did not solve this pattern problem analytically or by computational techniques. We solved it as a coloring book problem. I then built a custom computer-controlled milling device to cut the shapes out of aluminum and precisely locate the bolt holes, making the construction of this very large object possible. The project was completed in 1976. A second dedication occurred in 1978, coinciding with the visit of Queen Elizabeth II. Quasicrystals are non-repeating patterns, and thus an apparent paradox. We usually think of patterns as composed of regularly repeating elements. In quasicrystals, there is regularity. All the nodes, edge lengths, and two-dimensional shapes are identical. All the joints are in rows, and only two similar three-dimensional shapes make up the entire structure. Yet the pattern is non-repeating, consequently counterintuitive and intriguing. Computers are essential in the creation of quasicrystal patterns, and computer models reveal their visual fascination. In one view, a quasicrystal structure appears to be made up of cubic elements. In another view, the object appears to be a five-pointed star pattern. In a third view, it appears to be made up of triangles, hexagons, and other forms with threefold symmetry. Quasicrystal sculptures and architecture pieces are exquisitely and magically responsive to both changes in light and the movement of the viewer. Since 1970, I have used computers in sculpture to sense environmental phenomena and to create interactive situations. The microcomputer has made it possible to incorporate a powerful, dedicated computer and even quite small individual sculptures. These recent works use Motorola process control microcomputers, which can easily and quickly be programmed in the C language. Like several other recently developed microcomputers, they include versatile input-output interface circuitry right on the chip, making them easily adaptable to a wide range of control functions. Clouds are one of the more fascinating components of landscape and meteorological study. The meteorological information necessary for this project has to do with my general interest in the subject and my belief that science and art have much in common. These images are about mechanical production of images of air. The form air takes is that of cloud parts, the area between cloud and no cloud, since clouds have no surface and are intangible. Much of my work deals with the boundaries between the visible and invisible. The work also takes the form of defining space and revealing voids, concepts expressed in mechanically produced imaging via software and hardware. I'm investigating the relationship between space and void, focusing on various kinds of air surrounding clouds and cloud formation. My work is also about line, atmosphere, and time, things that suggest passage and things that are passing. I think about fixed points, connected space, and chaotic, unbridled expansiveness. My works are an exploration of architectural forms that are both imaginary and possible. The sculptures and drawings explore structure and place through forms such as temples, altars, and observatories. The works utilize new technology and also retain the accidents that an artist leaves as evidence of his work. These inventions are influenced by both modern and ancient works. They are not meant to be architectural models, they are imagined places. They are executed using traditional materials such as bronze, as well as contemporary media in the form of plasma cut and heliarc welded aluminum, computer simulations and drawings. The development of CAD programs for architects and solid modeling has been helpful in visualizing ideas in three dimensions. I employ a scanner to import some shapes and background images. The computer has extended the possibilities of visualizing ideas as a new kind of sketchbook. Since my work has lots of repeated forms and variations, the computer has been a natural for me. I began by using the computer as an enhanced model-making tool. That use has steadily expanded until now the computer is an indispensable part of my process. For me, it has never been a brainstorming device. The old-fashioned sketchbook serves me much better. However, I now move much more quickly from pencil and paper to the computer than ever before. What once was a very linear process, from pencil sketch to computer model to studio work, now has much more back and forth to it. I bring printouts of computer models into the studio, work from them and on them, and remodel them in the computer until a nearly complete rendering is finished. When I am asked to make a presentation for a commission, I go straight to a complete rendering, complete with animation and scanned backgrounds. Virtually all of my work is kinetic, and I can achieve far greater precision of movement with a computer model than I can with a small-scale physical model. I have found that clients can often understand a computer visualization with a scanned background better than a scale model. Three-dimensional work leads almost inevitably to animation, since moving the image of a piece in space is so compelling. The chance to play with reality and to indulge a strong interest in narrative work has led to a series of computer animations, one of which has a sculptural theme. Sculptor's Dream, Sculptor's Nightmare is about the pitfalls of believing too much in the computer's output.
This last segment that we saw belongs to you, David. You're the very David Smalley that was up on that screen. Some of what we saw, though, was real, and some of it was not really there. Mm-hmm. Tell me about that.
Well, is it real or is it Memorex? Actually, in some cases, the better-looking images were real, and the fuzzier ones were video taken at my own studio or my own yard. of some actual sculptures. The sculpture that you saw in front of the building, for instance, that was moving in with the arms moving back and forth, that's not really a sculpture. That's a computer visualization, and it was done in front of a scanned photograph of a building, happened to be a building at Brown University. Not because Brown owns that sculpture, but because I just wanted to put the sculpture in front of a kind of urban, see how the sculpture looked in an urban setting. So you do get into this idea. It's a little bit like the virtual reality you spoke about, Larry. Mm-hmm. That is, it's you know you're looking at a TV picture, so you don't really think you're being transported, but you're not sure if what you're seeing is an actual event or a portrayal of an event. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, this begins to get us into some kinds of questions about art. Mm-hmm. Is it art or is it imagination? Mm-hmm. What do we do with those kinds of questions?
I wonder why we would resist the thought that a visualization was art. I suppose it's because we presume that the work of art is something that stands in a public space.
And lasts.
Isn't
lasting,
sure.
Doesn't that have something to do with the traditional idea of what art is?
Absolutely. I mean, the aesthetic stance has been thought to be one where we let something stand, we don't intervene, we don't get involved, we let it show itself from itself. What these visualizations call into question is precisely that distinction between the aesthetic stance on the one side and the more technical or pragmatic stance on the other side. Because if the object is a mere visualization, then presumably it's something that one can manipulate and work with and what have you. It might change over time. The audience might get involved in the restructuring of it and what have you.
And if it's on your computer,
yeah,
or if it's on our computer,
sure,
it might become my piece.
Right.
Instead of your piece.
Yeah, that's true.
Who is the artist?
Mm-hmm.
And whose art is it?
Mm-hmm. This, by the way, is equally true with writing today. That is, there are some who claim that the notion of a book written by an individual author will, over time, become, if not obsolete, then not the culturally dominant way in which texts are produced. That people will write more collaboratively, passing paragraphs or sentences or fragments back and forth, and what have you.
We have a computer in the studio, and David now will show us on his computer how he can get started in a creative way using this machine, and we can then talk some more about these questions. David, show us how you can create with that tool.
Okay, what I'd like to do is show you a couple of simple things on the computer that are simple now, but really just a few years ago, maybe as recently as 7 or 8 years ago, were restricted to very, very powerful mainframe computers with software costing in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. And what I'm working on now is a computer that costed just a few thousand dollars and a piece of software that markets for $150. And so you see there's this wonderful trickle-down effect. Let me show you first how we can make some three-dimensional objects on the computer. What I'm doing now, if you look in the lower left-hand box, which is labeled front, is I'm drawing a very simple profile of a wine goblet. And now I'm going to ask the computer to lathe or sweep that profile around a circle, just as if I were working on a potter's wheel. And what we have now on the screen, if you look in the upper right-hand corner of the screen, is a real three-dimensional portrayal of the goblet. As you can see, I'm sort of tipping the goblet over so that you can look into the top of it, or I can have a look up at it from the bottom. It is very quick technology. It's a very quick way of visualizing an object. I can modify that object if I would like. Let me do a little fooling around with the computer here. Let's say that I would like to put a spout on this. Let's say I decide I don't want this to be a wine goblet, but a kind of a pitcher. And I can draw that goblet out now, and you'll see I'll spin it around here for us to get a look at. We've now modified that. Now, this is a long way from those smooth, slick, realistic images that you saw earlier. But it gives you an idea about how we can make a three-dimensional object. I'll show you another way. That's called lathing. And I'll show you another way that we can make an object. This is called extruding. It's a little bit like working with a cookie cutter. I'm going to make a star shape here. this is not a very good star, but then I don't work well under pressure. And I'm going to add some faces to it. The computer needs to understand whether it's a surface or an open space by having you fill it with triangles. And when it's filled with triangles, the computer understands that that's a real plane and not just a hole in the space. So I'm going around the star now and filling it in. But you can see, if you look in the upper right-hand corner, that this is a flat, let's get it to an end view, a pretty flat star. That is to say, it has no depth. It's really just a line. And so now what I'm going to do is ask the computer program to extrude this, and we'll give it certain thickness. And now, when I rotate the object for you, you can see that we've created a star that is actually a solid-appearing object. It has some substance to it. And we can get a bigger look at that in this view. Now, we can modify almost at will. That is, we can collect points on the object, and we can do various things to it once we've done that. For instance, I can select a batch of points now, and I can move this and modify the object that way. Let me show you some a couple of objects that I've already made, and show you a little bit about how the computer can become a very creative tool indeed. Here's a sphere, and let's load in another object. The second object that I've loaded in is a simple cutter. It's a shape that I made in the computer earlier. And what I'm going to do now is use it to literally slice through the sphere. And we'll be able, by doing that, to see some things that we really couldn't find in any other way. In other words, it would be almost as if I took a wire and cut. Let me get back to the right method here. Okay. And we'll let the computer do its magic here. And you'll see in just a moment that I not only have the sphere sliced into pieces, but I have a whole bunch of other shapes as well. And I'll see if we can show you that in some graphic fashion. Okay, we'll move that part along. And you can see that what we've got now are the different particles of the sphere. That are all moved, and okay, let's just get them back. Okay. And finally, we'll take our cutter and move it aside. And what we have now in this complicated mess, and I'm not sure the audience will see it as clearly as I'd like, but what we have are a whole bunch of forms that were created because I fractured that sphere into a lot of different segments. Now, each of those might be the trigger, the creative trigger, the idea for me to get some new aspects of form that I didn't have before.
David?
Yep.
Is there a way you can reconstruct the history of what you've done?
If I saved the object all the way, I could do that. Yes, let me walk over to the set.
You can save on your screen the way we save other things on our computers, and then go backwards into where it's been so that you can perhaps change at a certain level.
If I had taken the time, which I didn't because of the constraints of time on the show, if I had taken the time to save each step along the way, I could reconstruct that in some fashion. In fact, I could animate the creation of that form and have the computer play it back to me.
Sure.
And that process might be a creative process, mm-hmm. too, because mm-hmm. That's the one thing that you can't do in a traditional
that's
art
right.
medium.
Sure.
Yeah, you couldn't
you
do
become
that.
Disney.
That's right. And also, if I make a change in a piece of clay, I have, of course, lost the first version.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But if I've saved the first version and made a change in my computer model, mm-hmm. I never lose. I can always go back to the earlier versions. It's a wonderful tool for teaching because students can make changes in their work with no risk.
Not to mention cost.
Right.
The trouble and the cost of working with the real stuff, metal for sure, you and clay. You can't go backwards. You have to either dump it if you make a mistake.
Well, artists traditionally work, especially sculptors, work with models. The difference is that now I can make a model that's not a physical model. Often, especially with my work, it's more difficult to make a small physical model that has some of the qualities of the final piece. It's almost more difficult to do that than to do the real scale piece. Aside from the cost of materials, one finds oneself working like a watchmaker or a jeweler with a whole different set of tools. So there is this kind of freedom that I find. Also, frankly, after having worked with this for several years, the idea that the computer screen is not a flat place, but a kind of cube of space that can be any scale, I find very enriching.
But Larry, tell me about, where's the original? What's going to happen with the copies? In terms of art, haven't we not grown up to believe that what's really important is the original?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's an essay from the earlier part of the 20th century by Walter Benjamin called Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, in which the question was raised about precisely whether the work of art had to be a kind of unique object that was created by an artist with a certain intention, what the status of having copies would be. And one of Benjamin's thoughts was that there's a certain aura about the work of art that had to do with its being an original and with the thought that there couldn't possibly be absolute reproductions of that work. One of the things he wanted to suggest was that aura was perhaps not a good thing. That is, it put all too much emphasis on the sort of lonely artist creating that precious work and played into an art market that has an interest in unique objects, which of course raises the value of a work of art.
Sure.
So part of the motivation for resisting the idea of copies is an economic one. Once you take the economic factor out of it, there's a serious question as to why one should have qualms about copies. But then again, there is a serious point here, which is something went into the original that didn't go into the copies. Although, in the case of computer art, it's not clear what that relationship is. That is, there's not as wide of a gap between the original computer visualization and any copy of it as there is between a Rembrandt and any copy of it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's not clear that there's
exactly.
a fundamental difference in the case of computer art between the original and the copy. Whereas in the case of Rembrandt and the copies, we would say, that's a Rembrandt, the copies are not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No matter how close to the copy,
sure.
You get somebody better, with a better eye,
yeah.
A more thorough connoisseurship, and they will be able to tell you.
Yeah, right.
Because intrinsically there's a difference,
right.
but here there's not.
In the computer case, why should we worry that there are seven of David Smalley's visualizations available? The original has no special status as a thing compared to the copies, whereas with respect to David's physical sculptures, presumably that original is the one that he put his time and labor and thought into. And any copies of it would be sort of facsimiles. It would be hard to get the identical copy that you could get with a computer visualization. And furthermore, if somebody else did it, it would just be a mere copy.
Mm-hmm. I guess my contention is that art has value because it's rare. Now, that may be because there aren't many original objects. If artist values go up, when an artist dies, supply is cut off, demand presumably increases in relation to that fixed or ended, the end of the supply chain, and it becomes more valuable. I would like to see us get to the point where art is scarce because good ideas are scarce, and not because physical objects don't exist in large numbers. So when I work on the computer, as opposed to when I work in the studio, the sculpture studio, the value of the work, and I would hope the scarcity of the work has to do with whether the ideas are rare. Mm-hmm. And that goes to this idea of the hand too. I think we've prized art in the past because only certain people had a particular kind of ability to do a certain kind of copying, mm-hmm. representational work. Now we're at a stage where maybe we'll begin to prize the conceptual part of what an artist does more than the manual part.
It seems to me, just as a real observer, that there's been a crisis that's haunted art in the 20th century, which has to do with how you really know who's a great artist and who's a faker. And in the computer art, what you're suggesting, David, is that you have to be able to identify the concept, the originality of the concept. And one of the questions would be, do you feel comfortable being able to spot that?
Well, as a teacher, I look at work produced by students of varying abilities all the time, and often, in fairness to a student, I need to get past a kind of, let's say, physical talent, an innate ability, such as one would find on a basketball court or a student who draws particularly well, and find out the quality of thought and effort and creativity that's gone into it. So I personally don't have the difficulty that you're pointing to. Mm-hmm. Also, if not lots of money is involved, in other words, if we're not worried about whether we've spent $20,000 on a fake, but we're just worried about whether we've taken the time to look at something, maybe that makes the issue a little less painful. We ought to look at lots of things. We ought to be engaged by what we see. Mm. And not worry so much about whether we've been taken in. After all, there's not a lot of profit to be made with computer art anyway. It's not an established market.
Not yet, the way
fine paintings are. And so I would like to, I guess, minimize those concerns a bit and just have people look and enjoy.
Mm-hmm. It does seem as though the art world, though, is getting more and more populated and not less. There are many more artists than there used to be, and certainly there is a larger audience than ever. Art seems to be everywhere in very different kinds of ways, and I suppose there are both good things to say about that and lesser. Our time today, I think, has helped our audience at least get to know what the newest kid on the block is all about, so that when they see it, they can become a part of the interaction, whether it's in the magnetic field kind of work, or whether or not it's looking at a computer and seeing different shapes and wondering and being able to think how that might be created in real space. It will help them, I know. And I'm glad that they were able to spend this time with us. And I thank you both, Dr. Smalley and Dr. Vogel, for coming into the studio with your tools and your thoughts and helping us get some of these questions even begun to be talked about, certainly not quite answered. Thank you very much.
Our pleasure.
This is Rona Rutchik.
Thank you.